Okay, there we go. Alrighty.
3, 2. Hi, everybody. This is Phil of Netflix and Phil, and I am so honored and grateful to have a very special guest. This is an exclusive for Netflix and Phil. I have Jeffrey Reddick with me. We're going to get into your career path and history. I'm sure many know of you and know what you have created in the horror genre and beyond. But first off, I understand you own 2 cats. Is that correct?
Oh, yeah. Two black cats, and one of them looks like a bat. He's got fangs and everything. So his name is Damien.
I love it.
Once I'm talking to people, he'll probably make an appearance at some point.
I hope Damien materializes. Well, I want to get into the film and television aspect of your career here shortly. But first, let's talk about your past and history. I know we were going to meet a few weeks back, and some stuff happened in your hometown. I'm wondering if you can speak to that and where you grew up.
I grew up in Eastern Kentucky, so I'm a proud hillbilly. Kentucky got really hit hard. My hometown in that county got hit really hard by the flooding in Kentucky, so it really devastated the region. And then, sadly, about a week after, one of my friends lost everything. He took his life, which, you know, is never easy when that happens. It was a pretty stressful period. It still is, you know, there's a lot, it's going to take a long time for the air to recover. So when tragedies and natural tragedies and happen, and then also when people, you know, that, you know, get to the point where they just kind of feel like there's no hope left in the world. So, you know, I always take that as a reminder to let people know they're valued and tell, you know, people if they're suffering or struggling to get help, because there's no shame. And, you know, I've been sober for like 15 years, so I'm very honest about that, because I think we just need to take away the shame of reaching out for help for any kind of struggles, whether it's addiction or mental health issues.
Well, and congratulations on your sobriety, and I am sorry for your loss. And I thank you for sharing that. And in today's world, with the climate and everything that's going on, it's just, you never know what's coming down the pipeline, and it's a little bit scary right now.
Yeah.
Okay, well, let's continue on. I do want to talk about family a little bit, and I've seen on Twitter you often mention her, and I think she celebrated a birthday recently. Your sister, what can you tell us about
Shana,
her?
Yeah, she's awesome. I won't say how many years younger she is than me. We'll just say she's many, many, many years younger than me. But, you know, she's, you know, my only sister and my only sibling, and just a great, strong woman. She takes a lot after my mother. She served in the Navy, and she's in the Army Reserve, so she's a veteran, and she still works, you know, outside of that. So just a really strong, inspiring, you know, sister to have. So I love her to death.
And I appreciate when you always share about her on Twitter, and I'm an only child, so I'm always kind of jealous of people that have siblings, because I never really grew up with anybody, so I always kind of have envied that. So
we fight and stuff, so it's not always sunshine and rose. No, but again, she's awesome. So I couldn't ask for a better sister.
Well, I'm glad to hear it. Okay, so I want to kind of transition to movies, and I want to know how you kind of got not only involved in horror, or how you got exposed to it, and what makes you yourself a fan of the horror film genre.
Yeah, I mean, my first exposure that I remember was sneaking in to watch a bit of Salem's Lot when my mom was watching it, but she wouldn't let me watch it, so she sent me to bed. But then I snuck in and watched it, and unfortunately, I came in the scene where Danny Glick shows up at the window and is like scratching to like, yeah. So I saw that scene, and then it terrified me. I had to sneak in my mom's room and sleep by her bed for a couple of nights.
Sure.
And my sister and mom shared a big bed. My sister knew that I was sneaking in there, and she knew that I couldn't say anything because mom would get really pissed if she found out. So my sister would bring stuff to bed and like throw shit at me in the middle of the night. So that was my first that's the first memory of horror that was kind of burned into my brain. But I was born in Kentucky, but I claim Florida, but I claim Kentucky as home because that's where I really spent my formative years and, you know, growing up through middle school, high school, college. So we moved to Kentucky and, you know, I became friends with a couple of guys. One of them was the one who took his life, unfortunately, Tony and Calvin. And we just started watching horror films. And, you know, being teenagers, at first it was more kind of the cool factor of we were doing something that everybody else was like, how can you watch that stuff? It's gross. And then, but we would get Fangorias and we'd kind of learn how they made the magic happen. And we, you know, we loved it and it was kind of a taboo thing. And then I saw A Nightmare on Elm Street, which is kind of my favorite film of all time, the original. And Wes Craven's probably the filmmaker who's inspired me the most. But, you know, that movie like made me fall in love with the genre because I thought it was so imaginative, so well written. Horror sequences were just amazing. And Heather Langenkamp is still my favorite kind of final girl in horror film. She was, you know, many have followed and there were many before, but she was the one that really just didn't run from the killer and then kill him at the end. Like, she kind of pieced together early on something was going on. She started investigating. She booby-trapped the house. She pulled Freddy out. Like, she was a really proactive final girl. And so that movie really made me fall in love with the possibilities of the genre beyond just scaring people. And, you know, I started reading about interviews with Wes Craven, and he was a very, you know, very educated man and had a lot of, you know, even some of his really shocking work like Last House on the Left and things like that, you know, there was subtext to those stories, you know, you wouldn't get unless you were told. And I started going, oh, you can make horror movies that are not just about killing pretty people. You can have other stuff in it too. So after A Nightmare on Elm Street, I got hooked. And, you know, I've told it a lot, but, you know, I wrote a prequel idea and I found out the address for New Line Cinema and found out that Bob Shea ran the company, and I mailed it to him. And, you know, I'm this hillbilly, you know, again, hillbilly in Kentucky. I don't know anything about the movie business. And he sent it back to me and he's like, you know, we don't take unsolicited material. So I sent it back to him and I was like, you know, look, sir, I've spent like $3 on your movies. I think you can take 5 minutes to read my story. And he actually read it. This was luckily, like, I hit them at the right time, but when New Line was taking off because of Nightmare on Elm Street, but they hadn't turned into like the big powerhouse studio that they would become. So Bob had time to like answer a kid's email from Kentucky, or snail mail from Kentucky. And he got back to me and he was very encouraging. His assistant, Joy Mann, who became like such a strong mentor for me, and she's no longer with us, unfortunately, but she used to send me scripts and send me, like, you know, toys from the movies and like posters. And she just really encouraged me, and Bob encouraged me. So I kind of kept that connection, you know, going throughout my high school and college years. And then when I was a sophomore in college, I went to New York to study acting, and they offered me an internship at New Line Cinema over the summer. But, you know, the acting course was at the American Academy of Dramatic Arts, and it was for the summer, but I ended up getting an agent through that. And so getting an agent combined with getting an internship at New Line, I was like, I don't need to go back to school. Screw this. I'm going to stay in New York and make it. Cut to 10 years later when I sold Final Destination. But behind every like overnight success, there's a long story of like hard work and trying and failing and growing that happened. But yeah, I got to work at a film studio. So that really, you know, especially the studio that made the franchise that I love so much, A Nightmare on Elm Street. So I got to learn how films were made and, you know, how decisions were made. And so it really was a great education in the business and horror specifically, because they did a lot of really cool horror films.
Right, and that's kind of how they broke into the market, not only with Nightmare on Elm Street, but ensuing motion pictures. And I admire how he and Joy kind of took you under their wing and curated and helped to get you interested not only in the filmmaking process, but it led to what I'd like to talk about now, a film franchise that you are known for, and you mentioned it earlier. Cut to 10 years later, we get Final Destination.
Yeah. And, I gotta look that up on Google. I know nothing of it now.
No, yeah. Well, I'm sure you know quite a bit, and take as long as you like, or give us the Cliff's Notes. But I personally, and I'll just to give you my backstory, I was exposed to Final Destination when I lived in L.A. And you may know this, but I worked at a video rental establishment, one that was in the Valley, and it also had a location in West Hollywood. It was called Video West. Do you
remember? Oh, yeah. Yeah, I remember Video West. Absolutely.
I worked there for years. And I, a devout horror fan, had not seen Final Destination until it came to video. I don't even know if DVD was available yet, but it was kind of around that time.
Yeah.
And always our closing practice was, let's put on a movie as we're closing up the shop, you know, and you see it on the overhead monitors in the store. A coworker of mine is like, you got to see Final Destination. And that was my first exposure to it. And I was like, as I'm sweeping up Video West in the Valley, I'm catching glimpses of this. And I'm like, oh, I really need to invest in this. So I'm just very curious about the genesis, because one, I think the idea and how the lead character typically always has a premonition or an idea about some fate that's going to befall him, and characters integral to the movie. And I just love how that is conceptualized in the original film and it's peppered throughout the sequels.
You know, the kernel for the idea came when I was flying home to visit my family in Kentucky, and I read an article about a woman who was on vacation, and she was supposed to fly home the next day, and her mom called her and said, I have a bad feeling about that flight. I think you should change flights. And then she changed flights and found out later that the flight she was on crashed. Mm-hmm. So I read that on a plane and I was like, oh, this is interesting. But I you know, it took me a while to figure out a story for it. And the first iteration was actually, you know, I was trying to get a writing agent at the time. And so they always asked you to write a spec script. So they wanted you to pick a popular show on TV and then write a sample of that show in your voice. And so I used that idea as an X-Files episode to send to an agent. And it never went to the show. Like, I know on some sites it says, oh, it was sent to the show. It never went to the show. But it did get me an agent. And the people at New Line were like, this is a great idea for a feature. You should develop it. Some friends of mine that worked with me at New Line, Chris Bender, he started working for a couple of producers, Craig Perry and Warren Zeid, who had a first look deal at New Line. And by this point, I'd had enough scripts rejected by New Line that I knew I had to play a little bit smarter with this one. So I wanted to bring some producers on board before coming back to New Line, and they had a first look deal with New Line. So, you know, I developed the story with them, and originally it was going to be all adult characters, and I kind of used that for the second movie, but then Scream came out, and so it's like, let's make them teenagers, and which I'm like, fine, absolutely. And you know, we developed it probably for like 5 or 6 months going back and forth with New Line, and the thing they kept bumping on was the idea that we didn't want to show death, and they're like we, that doesn't make any, you can't have a horror movie without like a Freddy or a Jay, like it doesn't make any sense if you don't show something that they're fighting.
I see.
And that was kind of where the rubber met the road for us, is we didn't want to do that. And so finally Craig and Warren said, well, if you guys pass on this, we're going to take it to Miramax, which was their competitor. So they're like, we'll buy it.
of course.
Then after they bought it, you know, I, you know, wrote the script, and you know, the kind of kismet thing is, you know, it ended up being directed, and then James Wong and Glenn Morgan, who worked on some of the best X-Files episodes, came on board and, you know, did a rewrite of the script and directed the film. So it kind of came full X-Files circle, which was kind of nice.
Well, I'm glad to hear that. And I appreciate hearing how they were bumping against, you know, whether do you personify death because of those popular Michael Myers or Freddy Krueger characters. And that's what I think is the most captivating thing about it, is you don't really see, or you can't sense like a presence or anything. It's just, it's this omnipotent thing that's coming after these individuals. That comes out and it's a success. So what's kind of the snowball effect after the original movie comes out?
Well, I was still working at New Line. So the movie actually was a true word of mouth kind of hit, because, you know, most horror movies open and then they drop probably about 50% their second weekend. And we were getting the daily tracking in, and the movie was actually holding steady and started going up at the end of the week. So by the second week, and it started going up the charts, it opened at number 3, and then I think it actually reached number 1. And so I knew pretty early on that they were going to want to make a sequel. So I wrote a sequel, you know, treatment like pretty quickly. I worked out of the New York office. I'm in typical Hollywood fashion. They went out to pretty much, you know, I moved out to LA after 9/11, and I met so many horror writers that were like, oh yeah, we went in for Final Destination 2. So they met with everybody in town before finally going, all right, we're going to take your story.
Unfortunately, I'm a little naive about the process and what you originally conceive of. And I think I read somewhere in an interview you did that what you originally conceive isn't necessarily exactly what appears on screen after it's all culminated and put together. Is that accurate?
Yeah, no, it usually, unless you're directing a movie, it usually never is exactly what you wrote. But the biggest difference, and I'm actually glad about this, I think the reason that Final Destination has had the legs it has, the main thing is we didn't show a personification of death. So it doesn't matter what your background is or where you're from or if you're religious or if you're not religious, it doesn't matter because there, you know, death is death. And so the fact that we kind of left a blank slate there allowed anybody from so many backgrounds to just fill in what death is for them. But the one thing that James and Glenn came up with, which I think also helped it a lot, was my original script. It, you know, it's pretty much the same story, but death's MO was different. Like death, and because it screwed up the first time it didn't get them, it couldn't just kill them. So it kind of played on their survivor's guilt. It was very much more of a kind of a Nightmare on Elm Street take where death played mind games on the characters until they ended up committing suicide or getting themselves in it. Like in the movie, like Todd gets hung in the bathroom.
Right.
And in my version, you know, death has kind of mind effed him enough where he rigs up a noose in the garage and we don't know it, but when he's calling his dad, apologizing for stuff, and the dad's racing home. And when the dad opens the garage, he ends up accidentally hanging Todd. So there's definitely a lot of parallels with my script, but mine was more of a Nightmare on Elm Street take. And I think with James and Glenn doing the Rube Goldberg device,
right,
I think it allowed the film to, again, reach an even broader audience than horror fans. Like, I think my version would have definitely been like a Nightmare on Elm Street kind of hit for horror fans, but I don't think people that don't normally watch horror like that, I get a lot of that. Like Final Destination was a lot of people's gateway into horror because they right. didn't watch horror before that. And then they saw that. It's always a process getting a film made. And I'm always very happy because I look at it like a play, like it takes a village to make a movie. So if people do stuff, I don't get really precious about my original idea if they do stuff to make it better. Like I do if they do stuff that makes it worse, which happens a lot. But in this case, I think the Rube Goldberg aspect also broadened the film out in a way that really helped it have legs. So,
well, and that's kind of its trademark in the original and the ensuing movies is the characters, you know, recognizing that they're next, so to speak.
Yeah.
And there's ramifications to, or the process or order in which they died in the premonition. I just think it's just so, like Nightmare on Elm Street, it's just such a creative aspect, and I think is what's helped the franchise to have its longevity.
You know, it was funny when I was developing it with a producer, like we had a great general story, but the producer was like, you know, I just feel like it needs one more thing. And then that's when I came up with the idea that they were dying in the order they would have died in the plane crash, because then that gives a design, that gives a character something else they can, they're not just running from the killer the whole time now, it's that they have the opportunity to hopefully fight back. So I'm really glad that, you know, Craig Perry, who's still a very active producer on the franchise, and I, you know, I'm really good friends with him, I think he's amazing. I'm always grateful that he pushed me, you know, to go that one step further with the film, because I think the design, the fact that death has a design is another thing that really helps set it apart.
One of my early celebrity crushes was Devin Sawa, of course.
Yeah, mine too. I'm friends with Devin now, so I tease him, but you know, Wild America with Devin Sawa and Jonathan Taylor Thomas and Scott Barstow.
Sure.
I mean,
yes.
Yes. Teen Beat, yes, absolutely.
That takes me back. Is there any chance we can get Devin back into a Final Destination film? I don't know.
My thing is, if you don't see somebody die on screen, you know the rule in horror. If you don't see them die on screen, then they could always be alive. But, you know, just going back to Devin for a minute, I think he's a huge part of why the movie is so successful. I mean, the whole cast is great. Like, I love all the cast members. But, you know, I wanted to kind of flip a couple of genre conventions. So I wanted to have a final guy instead of a final girl in this film. And, you know, I went to a horror convention in Mississippi this weekend. And, you know, part of that was they showed Screen Final Destination and we watched it again. And Devin just gives such a amazing performance in that movie. Like, it's, you know, he brings so much to that character, that crushability aside, he brings so much emotion and depth of that character. Like, he's just an amazing actor. I'm so glad he's also, you know, popping up in a lot of new horror stuff, like the Chucky series and
right
and stuff like that, because he's a great guy and a great talent. I've been a huge fan of Tony Todd's forever, and I remember seeing Candyman in college.